Ladies and gentlemen, we are about to start our second panel, Harmony and Conflict in International Financial Regulation. And I think that without any further ado, I'll just go ahead and hand it off to our esteemed moderator and panelists. Thank you.
Great. Thanks, Les, and welcome, everybody. For those who don't know me, my name is Gary DeWaal. I currently have my own consulting firm here in New York City specializing in financial services. But previously, I was something like 27 years, most recently as general counsel of a subsidiary of Societe Generale and Crédit Agricole. That was one of the world's largest brokers of exchange-traded derivatives. So I've been around for a long time, and before that, I was with the commission. I'm also myself a faculty practitioner at the Buffalo Law School. They have a program here in New York City in financial services, and I help out with that. We do have a very good and diverse panel. Regrettably, one of our panelists, Hélène Vletter-Van, had to cancel suddenly because of a family emergency back in Holland. So as the only other person of Dutch ancestry on this panel, I apparently get to pick up her portion of this topic. Going from my left, next to me is Dietmar Rieg, who is the president and CEO of the German-American Chamber of Commerce here in New York City. He's had that position since July 2013. And prior to that, like me, he was with a general manager and other positions with Bayer and Bank for a long time, both here in New York as well as back in Germany. So we're very lucky to have Dietmar with us. Next to Dietmar, we have George Pineau, who's currently with the European Central Bank. He's a permanent representative in Washington, D.C., and he's had a number of very, very important positions throughout his career with the Banque de France, the International Monetary Fund, the European Monetary Institute, and the European Central Bank. So again, we're very, very honored, and we're going to look forward to some of his important inputs on the topics we're going to cover. Continuing down the line, we have Eric Pan, who is Associate Director of the Office of International Affairs at the Securities and Exchange Commission in DC, where Eric is responsible for the international regulatory policy and comparative law for the commission. He is the senior SEC representative to the Financial Stability Board, IOSCO, the OTC Regulators Group, US-EU Financial Markets Regulatory Dialogue, and various other multilateral and bilateral organizations. Previously, he was a professor of law here in New York City at the Cardozo Law School, so we're very lucky to have Eric with us. And last but not least, all the way at the end there, is Dan Berkovitz, who's currently with WilmerHale after many, many years of governmental service, most recently as the general counsel of the Commodity Futures Trading Commission. Dan was very, very instrumental in the drafting of Dodd-Frank Title VII, so we'll have some good questions on that to him later on. But he's also served with the U.S. Department of Energy and the U.S. Nuclear Regulatory Commission. Dan has had some time on the Hill also. He's been a staff lawyer for the Senate Permanent Subcommittee on Investigations. He knows this stuff, and he also is an adjunct professor currently at the Georgetown University Law School. So hopefully, with the diversity of this panel, we'll be able to give you some good insight. The way we're going to structure this panel is, first, we're going to give you an overview of what you didn't learn at the first session, which is the European equivalent of Title VII of Dodd-Frank, which is principally a provision of law known as EMIR, the European Market Infrastructure Regulation. But just to sort of put you on the same plane, we'll give you a little background there. And then we're going to discuss the international application and issues surrounding Title VII and EMIR and the other relevant European statutes. We will then discuss, we'll then delve a little bit into the controversy regarding the international application of the various provisions, what some of the hot button issues are, why, as we speak right now, there is a meeting at the United States Commodity Futures Trading Commission between the senior director of the European Commission and the acting chairman of the CFTC to try to work out some matters. I'm actually optimistic I might get a report before we break that gives some insight, so we'll see. And then finally, we'll talk about a way forward. One thing I do want to just remind the panel, remind the audience, is that although our concentration here today will be on the international issues between Europe and the United States, those issues only account for the issues between two of the 20 signatories to the September 2009 Pittsburgh commitment. There are other issues out there. And for international players that participate in many of the world's markets, just resolving the situations now between the US and Europe is just the first step. It's probably the most difficult step, but there will be other opportunities down the road for other resolutions. So as I said, because Hélène has unfortunately not been able to join us, let me just remind you, to the extent you're not familiar with EMIR, the European Market Infrastructure Regulation, which is basically the law that was enacted, or the regulation that was enacted by the European Parliament and the European Council as a testament to their commitment to the commitments made at the Pittsburgh 2009 G20 summit. Now, in fairness to the Europeans, some of the issues and some of the promises had already been articulated in something called MiFID, the Markets in Financial Instruments Directive, that had been enacted many years ago, which had required the regulation of what we know basically as swap dealers, and had articulated already certain business conduct standards. EMIR then was a subsequent provision. It was adopted in July of 2012. It went into effect in August 2012. And much like Dodd-Frank, it provided for central clearing for certain classes of OTC derivatives. It called for the application of certain risk mitigation techniques for non-centrally cleared OTC derivatives. It called for reporting to trade repositories. It called for the application of organizational business conduct and prudential requirements to those central clearinghouses, affectionately known as CCPs. And it called for application requirements to trade repositories to make certain data available to public and relevant authorities. So some of the same transparency purposes of Title VII were included in EMIR. Now, you had the regulation of swap dealers in place, certain business conduct standards. You would now have some of the main provisions of Title VII. But you're still missing a piece of the puzzle, because you might remember that the 2000 commitment called for central execution of products that were required to be centrally cleared, and certain post-trade transparency issues, and certain matters around the commodity derivatives. Well, these finally look like they're going to be resolved through an amendment to MiFID, affectionately known as MiFID II, which was just agreed upon in principle last week by the European Parliament and European Council. And that will deal with, as I just said, the central execution of derivatives. And in particular, just one second here as I get my notes together. Now, some of the things that are covered by MiFID II is, in fact, that trading will occur, quote unquote, wherever appropriate on regulated platforms. There is going to be transparency in both the pre and post trade of transactions. There's going to be a position limit scheme for certain commodity derivatives traded on regulated markets, and there's a lot of controversy about how that will work out. There is going to be something called a non-discriminatory access to trading venues and CCPs provision. And this is very controversial, and I do want to get back to that a little bit later on. It's not controversial in the sense that it's a regulatory issue between Europe and the United States, but it's causing a lot of problems for some of the CCPs. Trading controls will be introduced under MiFID II. This deals with access to the electronic markets, particularly by the high-frequency traders, greater cooperation, and good things like that. Now, I mentioned the European Parliament. I mentioned the European Council. the equivalent of the CFTC and the SEC in Europe is an organization known as the European Securities and Market Authority. And basically, they are tasked by the EC to come up with the technical standards for which EMIR and MiFID II actually will be implemented. And in most cases, in many cases, they make recommendations to the EC that may or may not be adopted. For example, early last year, ESMA made a recommendation for reporting to trade repositories be delayed until later in 2014, and that was rejected. And in fact, the reporting to trade repositories now will be occurring next month. It will be beginning next month in Europe. There are, as I said, a lot of commonalities between Title VII and this combination of provisions. And by the way, let me also point out that when you look at Europe and you look at the pan-European regulation, and Dietmar and George probably are much more able to eloquently discuss this than I can, it's not just EMIR and MiFID I and II. You have to look at other directives and other rules. Basel III talks about the capital of banking, but very much plays into how banks are going to be reactive to the trading opportunities and even the carrying opportunities to deal with customer business. So there's all sorts of other directives that loosely impact how the derivatives markets will play out. But there are some differences. There are some subtle differences between Title VII and Dodd-Frank, not to mention issues around the extraterritorial application, which we'll get into in a few seconds. Some argue that the burden on end users under EMIR is less. The trade reporting, however, is more difficult. In the United States, trade reporting is typically by one of the parties. In Europe, trade reporting is by both of the parties. There's also a all parties have to report scheme in Europe, including the CCPs, potentially the clear trades. In the United States, it's a bit different how it's playing out. So we'll hear about some of them, but again, there are some differences in the application. Nothing is 100% ideal. So I just want to give you that general oversight. And now what I'd like to do is turn over to Dan. First of all, let's talk about some of the extraterritorial application. Let's start with the United States side. How is, in general, what is the basis for the extraterritorial application of Dodd-Frank outside the United States? And how has the CFTC approached that so far? And then we'll look at how the SEC has approached that.
Well, thank you, Gary. There's two basic provisions that direct the CFTC in the application of the statute extraterritorially or cross-border, as it's often called. One is the substantive provision that's in Section 2I of the Commodity Exchange Act, which was added by Section 722 of the Dodd-Frank Act. And the other is Section 752 of the Dodd-Frank Act, which directs the CFTC and other financial regulators to consult and coordinate with foreign authorities to seek harmonization. So one is the substantive and the other is the procedural. I'll give a little background on 722, or as I mentioned, it's now Section 2I of the Commodity Exchange Act. And Section 2I of the Commodity Exchange Act says essentially that the provisions of this act relating to swaps, the swaps provisions of the Commodity Exchange Act, which were all added by Dodd-Frank, prior to Dodd-Frank, the CFTC did not have jurisdiction over the swaps market. The provisions relating to swaps in the Commodity Exchange Act shall not apply, it's written in a double negative, shall not apply to activities outside the United States unless those activities, one, have a direct and significant connection with activities in or effect on commerce of the United States. So that's the direct and significant connection test with activities in or effect on commerce of the United States. There's a second clause, which also gives the CFTC and statute extraterritorial application. The distinction that I just made there is a significant one, which I think we'll talk about a little later, between the CFTC's authority and the application of the statute. This is a self-executing statute.
that does not need rulemaking generally to implement, but the second provision does need a rulemaking unless it's contravenes such rules or regulations as the commission may prescribe or promulgate as are necessary or appropriate to prevent evasion of any requirement of this act. So Congress is clearly concerned with the potential for structuring activities overseas, U.S. entities going overseas to conduct their activities, to structure their operation in such a way as to evade the territorial application of the Dodd-Frank Act. As I mentioned, the evasion section requires a rulemaking in order to enact the prohibitions. The first provision, the direct and significant connection test, does not require a rulemaking. It's the act does not apply unless there's a direct significant connection, which the CFTC interprets basically double negative as a positive, that the CFTC has jurisdiction when there is a direct and significant
connection. And Dan, I just might interrupt at this point to say, and Europe has basically the same, EMIR has the same type of language. They use a slightly different standard. They use a direct, substantial, and foreseeable effect. That's the test they apply in looking abroad to see whether there's an impact. And they also, like the U.S., have a provision that allows them to do something to prevent evasion. So there is a fair amount of commonality of the language, although the test is slightly different.
Now, in the standard that's in 2I has a parallel in the antitrust law. In 2010, when Dodd-Frank was being considered late 2009, early 2010, this was in the aftermath of the Supreme Court decision in Morrison versus National Bank of Australia, which involved our sister agency here, the Securities Exchange Commission, where the SEC had tried to bring an action for violation of Rule 10b of the Securities Exchange Act. And the Supreme Court in that case ruled that unless Congress is explicit in the statute has extraterritorial application, it's presumed not to. So with the holding of the Supreme Court that there wasn't going to be extraterritorial application absent explicit statutory direction and intent by Congress, the committees of jurisdiction, as the legislation was going through, asked the agency to suggest some potential language to ensure that the statute would have extraterritorial application. And we looked around, and the antitrust language, the Foreign Trade and Antitrust Improvements Act, had been enacted in the 1980s or so, and that was the model. The language in this statute is very, very close to the language in the antitrust laws about how the antitrust laws have cross-border application. So that was the model for this provision. There's some slight wording differences, which the CFTC addressed in its guidance, but that was the basic principle underlying it. Embedded in the principle of cross-border application in any statute, this is also in the line of Supreme Court cases, is the principle of international comity. Even when the statute applies cross-border, the Supreme Court, unless Congress is very explicit otherwise, will interpret the statute in a way that does not unduly interfere or create unreasonable interference with non-U.S. jurisdictions, that Congress is presumed not to pass a statute. It's going to create all sorts of international problems for the United States. That's consistent with the other cross-border provision, 752, which is actually goes further and is an affirmative obligation on the CFTC, the SEC, and the prudential regulators to work in harmony, to harmonize, consult, and coordinate with foreign regulators towards harmonization. It doesn't condition anything on harmonization or say unless it's harmonized it's not effective, but it's a direction to harmonize. So in the rulemaking process and follow, there's been extensive consultation and coordination. The CFTC, the SEC have worked very closely together during this process, and there's also been extensive coordination with the foreign regulators throughout the process.
It's very interesting. You described that, though, as a procedural provision, yes?
Yes.
Not as a substantive provision, even though it the language is pretty clear. It says, when appropriate, there should be consultation and coordination, yes?
With the objective of harmonization.
Right.
Harmonization is clearly objective. Congress wanted to harmonize and was seeking that, directing the agencies toward that goal.
Yeah, I'm not sure everyone necessarily agrees. It's just a procedural approach. Go ahead. We'll ask our European friends in a few seconds.
Go ahead.
So you're going to talk to now. How did the CFTC go about instituting Dodd-Frank to the extent that there were cross-border issues?
Okay, so the commission was faced with, as I mentioned, we had the statutory provision that says it shall not apply unless there's a direct and significant connection. The Dodd-Frank Act was very explicit when it was passed, which provisions required rulemakings or not. This provision was one of many, which creates a whole new regulatory framework for swaps, which you've heard about earlier. And in that, the original statute in Dodd-Frank basically directed the commission to promulgate rulemakings for a number of those authorities. Some of these were mandatory rulemakings. Other rulemakings were not mandatory. And there were deadlines associated with them. The cross-border application was not a mandatory rulemaking. The highest priorities for the agency in implementing the act were obviously the mandatory rulemakings. The question came up as the agency was undertaking these rulemakings, what about cross-border application? How are you going to address that? Why don't you do a rulemaking on it, was one suggestion. Now, that is an option. The SEC, for example, has published a proposed rule on cross-border application. In the SEC's proposed rule, all of the rules and all of the cross-border application for each of the rules is addressed. It's a 1,000-page release, and it's comprehensive. And it's holistic approach in one document as to how the cross-border provision shall apply, and you can go provision by provision, how the clearing requirement, how the trading requirement, how the reporting requirement, how the various registration requirements all shall apply in one document. The CFTC, the thinking at the time was, we've got a congressional mandate to do these rules in a year. The congressional mandate, the statute was enacted in July of 2010. The congressional mandate was, within 1 year, you shall do all these rulemakings. So we were going to do the mandatory rulemakings and try to get them done in a year. As it is, it took about 2.5 to 3 years, which is still quite astonishing since it's ended up about being about 55 rules in that period of time. So at the time, rather than do a separate rule on cross-border, it was thought we would issue guidance. What does 2I mean? What is this direct and significant test, and then you could apply the guidance, say, okay, here's the framework, here's how we interpret 2I, and this will govern the application of each of these rules in the cross-border context, sort of overlying statutory interpretation would then apply to each regulation. There was concern, frankly, the concern was at the time, if you took an approach which would have structurally looked like what the SEC was doing, every single rule would have had individually a cross-border component to it. And there would be notice and comment on not just the domestic application, but the cross-border application of every rule during the rulemaking process. And the argument would have been, you can't do anything until you do everything. In other words, how can you just pick out a piece, the domestic piece, without doing the cross-border piece if it's one rule and one big comment period? And, so, and a U.S. entity would say, well, you have to consider the cross-border effect and on our foreign competitors, and we have to have level playing field. And all those arguments would have come in every rule. Without a legislative requirement to do the rulemaking that way, there was a lot of concern within the agency that that would have significantly slowed down the rulemaking process.
Dan, was there, I mean, in layman's words, was there just sort of a belief that, in fact, the law and the rules that mandated conduct or behavior, they were clear, or they would be clear, and they would articulate what you had to do, and that by issuing the guidance, in fact, you guys were doing the international community a favor by sort of saying the things that were taken out.
Yes, exactly. Here's the rules. The thinking was that we would issue rules that were clear in their application, certainly in the domestic context. And if you're a U.S. Person or U.S. entity in New York and other ones in California, that guidance would be clear what the rule was, whether it's registration or reporting or clearing or whatever. And then the question was, well, what if I'm in London rather than in New York? How would it apply in that context? And the guidance that the agency would issue would say, well, it would address that thing. How would it apply to a bank in London versus a bank in New York? And you could take the principles of the guidance and apply them in each particular circumstance. You wouldn't have to do 60 specific rules. You could articulate some overarching principles of looking how strong the connection was. And that was the other aspect of it too. The varieties and the fact patterns are infinite in terms of connections with the United States, in terms of legal structures. You're a subsidiary or an affiliate in the Caymans with a nerve center in New York, and you're booked in Paris, and there's just all these variations, and if you tried to address each one of them by rule, it'd be very complex and potentially time consuming. So overarching principles, look at the strength of the connection. It's a direct and significant connection. What constitutes a direct and significant connection? What do you need? What are the key factors the commission is going to look for in establishing that connection?
Now, Jeff, before you go further, now, Eric, the SEC had the advantage of having seen the CFTC proposed guidance come out, and rather than follow issuing their proposed guidance, they did, as Dan just mentioned, issue a proposed rule. Yeah. Why did the SEC take a different approach in this cross-border arena? What was the thinking at the SEC?
So let me just begin by giving the standard disclaimer that all the views that I'm expressing today are personal views and do not necessarily reflect the views of other staff, the commissioners at the Securities and Exchange Commission.
Okay, now tell us the real truth.
Which we have to say. The thinking at the SEC was, what made OTC derivatives unique compared to, for example, other markets that the SEC regulates, the broker-dealer space, equity markets, debt markets, is that we always believed it was truly a global market to begin with, right? This notion that you can say that there's a U.S. derivatives market or a domestic derivatives market we just did not think that was a true statement. It was a single derivatives market. And the empirical evidence kind of bored us out. If you look at certain CDS products, we were finding that over 90% of the transactions involved counterparties located in more than one jurisdiction. And so our thinking from the get-go was that cross-border was something that had to be addressed as a rule. Now, in all fairness to the CFTC, I mean, the fact is they were the first ones to write their rules. If you think about, we heard earlier this morning the general notion of a G20 commitment and all the G20 members, the CFTC not only was the first one to write the rules in the United States, they were the first ones to write the rules and finalize rules in the world. And the ones, even though everybody missed the G20 commitment to do derivatives regulation by end 2012, the CFTC definitely got the best marks. And they made a choice that really was trying to hold truest to what they thought the commitment was. The SEC, we have done a comprehensive cross-border release. It came out in May 2013. It's not quite 1,000 pages, but we were getting up there. I don't recommend you read the entire release. It'll take you a very long time. But there actually is a very handy fact sheet that the staff had put out that gives you the high-level principles in the release. Our plan, however, is not to then finalize a cross-border rule. Rather, we've now proposed all of our rules under Dodd-Frank, Title VII. We've done clearing, we've done reporting, we've done it for market intermediaries, including securities-based swap dealers. We're doing it for trading. And as these rules get finalized, they will contain cross-border, kind of call it a section on cross-border of how those rules apply. Now, I think that there's pluses and minuses to this. Our internal view was that this would bring greater certainty, greater clarity. The notion of getting notice of full comment from the public would be valuable in trying to figure out what was very complicated issues. The hypotheticals that Dan talks about, multiple connections of parties located in one jurisdiction booking into a third jurisdiction, we felt required it by choice, not as a legal requirement. We thought just required as a good idea to get public comment. But the cost has been the fact that we're still in the process of implementation and the CFTC regime is in place.
Now, Dan, just substantively, I want to get the European view, but I just want to set the table a little bit better first. What was some of the big proposals in the initial proposal? What were some of the big ideas that were articulated in what went out in June of 2012?
The key concepts in the proposal, one of the fundamental blocks is of a U.S. person. A U.S. person was described as somebody who's a resident of the U.S., an entity that has its place of business or is organized within the U.S., and funds where the ownership was in the U.S., for example. And the concept of a U.S. person was somewhat of a proxy for an entity that had a direct and significant connection with the U.S. If it wasn't a territorial, it had a territorial component, clearly, if you were in the U.S., but it was a test that was, these are the types of entities that are so closely related to the U.S. or have financial resources in the U.S., they would, transactions with them would constitute a direct and significant connection. So you could tell by the nature of the counterparty alone whether you satisfied that test in 2I of a direct and significant connection. You could look at your counterparty and say, are you a U.S. person under the guidance? And if they were, then a certain set of rules would apply. And if they were not, then perhaps another set of rules would apply, depending on the particular requirement. So fundamental was the concept of U.S. person, and that was a tool to help determine the direct and significant connection. Other key component was that non-U.S. persons who were transacting with U.S. persons would be subject to Dodd-Frank. That was the direct and significant connection if you had a transaction. So if you did a certain number of swaps with U.S. persons, if you were a non-U.S. person and you did a certain number of swaps with a U.S. person over the threshold for registering as a swap dealer, you as a non-U.S. person had to register with the CFTC as a swap dealer for all your activities. And that was a critical feature of the proposed guidance, that basically once you're in for everything. You weren't just a limited swap dealer for your dealing with U.S. persons. You were a bank in France, and you went over the threshold and you're dealing with U.S. persons, then the entire bank would be registered as a, that the entire legal entity that had the dealing in it would be registered as a swap dealer. And along with that came application of Dodd-Frank rules. The commission divided up the rules or categorized them into two categories. They're categorized as entity-level rules, which would apply to swap dealers, such as capital requirements, such as chief compliance or officer requirements, such as risk management. Those are entity-level requirements. Then there were transaction-level requirements, such as you had to clear your swaps, you had to report, you had to clear your swaps, you had to trade them on a platform. These are requirements or margin requirements. These were requirements that applied to specific transactions rather than the entity as a whole. For transactional requirements, if you're dealing with a U.S. person, you were subject fully to Dodd-Frank. If you're dealing with non-U.S. persons, in many instances, you were not. So there was a gradation there based upon the categorization of requirements and the nature of the counterparty. So that was fundamentally the thrust of the guidance.
Now, one thing I think it would be good for the audience to recognize is that even before the CFTC and the SEC rolled out these cross-border proposals, each agency had a regime for dealing with cross-border issues beforehand in connection with their basic space. In the CFTC world, there was a jurisdiction called a provision called Part 30 of the rules, which allowed non-U.S. Brokers, for example, certain non-U.S. brokers to access U.S. persons. There were rules that allowed non-U.S. persons to execute trades for U.S. persons. The SEC had not exactly a similar, maybe a bit more restricted type of regime under 15A6, but it also allowed for certain types of non-U.S. brokers to access certain types of U.S. persons is a far more restrictive provisions. Question to both Eric and Dan. Why was not the historical approaches followed in proposing a new way of dealing with the international arena.
Do you want to give me my theory? Okay, I think part of it is you have to kind of put yourself in the position of both of us at the time, which is going back to the other Dodd-Frank provision about coordination and cooperation and consultation, is that we were talking with our fellow regulators quite intensively. Since 2011, we were having very frequent conversations with the European Commission, with ESMA, the Japanese, et cetera. And the primary concern was, if you're trying to stitch together a global market, you want to avoid gaps, overlaps, and conflicts, right? You know, gaps are where if you draw your circles of your application of your rules and you leave areas blank, that's where the business is going to flow, right? Overlaps are what happens when you have overlapping circles, but the problem is, because of the need to comply with multiple regimes, costs become very high for the regulated entity. And conflicts, of course, is this notion of you have overlapping regimes that don't really work with each other, and they actually make the transaction impossible, right? You know, and that, of course, is the worst thing that could happen, because you're basically destroying a market if you do that. So that was one consideration, is what are you doing to ensure that you are truly stitching over your regimes with your fellow regulators. Now, as to the legal issues, which Dan can speak to much better than I can, you know, the other factor I know that we were thinking about in the commission, and it's stated in our proposing release on cross-border, is we got a lot of comment letters about Morrison. Morrison kind of required some additional analysis as to our jurisdictional reach. But, you know, as our cross-border release indicates, we felt that we were on very solid ground, given the fact that everywhere that we were applying our regime or proposing to apply a regime was based upon a territorial approach. Now, you're going to hear the word extraterritoriality quite a bit. I always find that to be a very misleading term. Every regulatory regime, whether it's European or American, is extraterritorial in some nature. But the real question is, what's the basis of the jurisdiction? And we, at least at the SEC regime, and I believe the CFTC regime, follows a territorial approach that happens to have application to branches of firms that may be located abroad and things of that nature. So it wasn't that 15A6 obviously had deep influence, but it wasn't seen as we had to bind ourselves to the 15A6 approach.
I would add, I'd agree with what Eric said. I would add a couple things. One is the approach that Gary described in the futures world, where the CFTC could recognize the regulatory programs in other jurisdictions, officially recognize it, and then the intermediaries or entities could do business in the United States while being licensed overseas, and not everybody in the world would be subject to CFTC regulation. You had exchanges and other countries regulating futures exchanges for a long time. The CFTC has had a lot of experience and a lot of high comfort level with futures regulations in a lot of other jurisdictions, and where it's found comparable regulation, there's a long track record. In the swaps area, we were all starting from scratch, you know, in 2009. So you really didn't have the existing comparable regimes where you could point to and say, and have a degree of comfort that if you set up a regime and deferred or substituted compliance, that there would be something there, that there was a there yet. Okay? And we're all, as Eric mentioned, put yourself back 2 to 3 or 4 years in 2009, 2010, as you're starting down this road, a lot of uncertainty as to the ultimate commitment. Yeah, the G20 goal is great, looked great in 2009 on paper, and that's what everybody said they were going to do, but who's going to follow through with it 4 years later? Is the people going to forget about the crisis? Is the political will really going to last for such structural changes? Remember, also, there was a lot of concern that there was going to be a lot of opposition to implementation of Dodd-Frank, that I think the luncheon speaker talked about, you know, the framework is here to stay. I don't know if the answer would have been the same from a lot of market participants three or four years ago before the rules got into place. People were afraid that maybe the rules are going to be too stringent. Maybe they will strangle the banking sector. Maybe people won't be able to raise capital. So from a regulator's perspective, you're trying to put these rules in. You don't know what the results in the other jurisdictions are. You didn't know what your fellow regulators in the United States, let alone international regulators. I think we're in a much, much different spot now, but we're saying why was the system structured the way it was. The CFTC did have components of substituted compliance. That was another key component of the proposal. In certain aspects where there would be a U.S. person or a CFTC-regulated entity subject to Dodd-Frank who was also in a foreign jurisdiction or a non-U.S. jurisdiction, in a number of circumstances, the CFTC guidance said, well, we will recognize substituted compliance for Dodd-Frank, either entity-level requirements on the dealers or transactional-level requirements for the transactions, pending a substituted compliance determination. But I will tell you, there was a real concern within the agency at the time, 2010-2011 time frame, that you didn't know where the end of the road was. And if you set up a regime that was heavily reliant on substitute compliance, two things might happen. One is, ultimately at the end of the road, the other regimes might not be really that stringent, and it would be very difficult as a political matter for a U.S. regulator, for the CFTC, for example, to say a European regulator is inadequate, and you just don't cut it. That politically, that'd be very hard for a U.S. regulator to find inadequacy. And so these substituted compliance determinations would come in, entities and jurisdictions would ask for them, and the political will wouldn't really be there to say, no, you've got to go back to your drawing board and pass some better legislation. Secondly, the gap, as Eric talked about, the gap problem. Even the best of intentions and the utmost confidence, what about the timetable? If there another jurisdiction is on a different timetable, maybe 2, 3, 4 years down the road, the pressure is going to be delay implementation application of Dodd-Frank until you see at the end of the road, and give them time to catch up. And then you won't have any cross-border application, and in that interim time period, everybody's going to go overseas. And when they all go overseas, then they're going to go over there, and then you're going to end up 4 or 5 years from now with a weaker non-U.S. regulatory regime. So you can't have a big gap. There was a concern about a big time gap, and that during that time gap, business would just go overseas. So those are really a couple, in the absence of a well-established regime already in existence, the confidence that you could ultimately get to substituted compliance wasn't yet established. I would add, though, as we've seen the years go by, I think we're in a very different spot now than we were a couple years ago in terms of potential confidence in terms of the world is indeed the harmonization process, all these consultations, and you look at the European legislation, I think the feeling is that these things are a lot closer. We have a lot more confidence and a lot more record now that the regimes are converging than there was 2 to 3 years ago. So,
and if I could just add a footnote, I mean, just a factual point.
You know you're speaking to lawyers when you say, if I could just add a footnote.
Well, you mentioned, you started off talking about MiFID II MiFIR, which was just, they just announced this month. That's the political agreement on MiFID II MiFIR. Mm-hmm. The actual final text doesn't come out until the end of April, and actual implementation isn't due to actually be completed until October 2016. So here we are, January 2014. It's a great achievement, but we still have got over 2 years before it actually enters the force. What do you do if you're a U.S. regulator? The timing, the mismatch in timing of implementation poses a big challenge.
Well, I guess the Europeans are a bit slow on that part. I have also to say what I say is privately and basically on observations I have made over the course of the last couple of years. Maybe I'm not a lawyer, so I have to speak in a lot of more layman's words. Maybe just a few remarks. Pittsburgh, the G20 meeting is very important, and I think everybody agreed this is a financial catastrophe, should never happen again, and it's mostly due to excessive risk and systemic risk. And then people looked around the markets and saw the derivatives market, and at that point it was about, I think, $700 trillion. If you compare that to the U.S., not only the U.S., to the world GDP, which was $80 trillion, It's a huge, huge dislocation there. And there was one particular market in there, the credit derivatives, which was about 60 trillion. That market didn't even exist in 1994, grew dramatically, and in my opinion, had contributed vastly to the crisis of 2008. I think the other derivatives, mostly on the FX side and on the interest rate side, even they were not regulated, did work very well at that point of time. Also interesting, the credit default swap market was basically invented after the Exxon Valdez disaster, so it came with two disasters after all. And this is why we are talking more or less exclusively about derivatives, although there are other things to be talking about. And one point I would like to make, and you asked that this morning also, is Basel II. It is correct that Basel II, in my opinion, also fired up the events to the financial crisis tremendously. But the real problem on this was Basel II was implemented by Europeans. So Europeans who held AAA securities, mostly from the US, mostly mortgage-backed securities, and in the worst case, CDOs, which were based on CDS. That's why that is so important. It's a pure artificial market with no real economy impacts, or basically no real economy impacts. They indeed had to hold very little if they had a standard approach, or no capital if they had other approaches. And that's why harmonization is so tremendously important, because I used to compare it and say, there was a cook cooking a lot of dishes, but never eating any of it. The European ate it, and it really came to this traumatic crisis. It's one very, very important, and I think very, very big issue. Now, when I, more on a naive point of view, you know, I look what the derivatives regulation should bring, and I think they're good ideas. It's central clearing. Central clearing for an economist basically reduces counterparty risk. So what happened to AIG cannot happen, because there's a clearer in between with collateral and so forth, which will always make sure that the other party is paid. Good thing, and should not be that complicated to be implemented. And the other one has to do with the reporting, the repository. That should create transparency. I think this is very important. All markets are transparent. Even if you want to buy an apartment next door, you go in Zillow and you find out what the next five around it cost, and how many, what the price was the last five transactions. And that idea is similarly true for that kind of issues. Now, what happened after that also is that basically I have here a page with two pages, which talks about definition and clearing. Although the G20 said this is what we need to do, the principles are there, and the rules come out completely different. And they continue to come out different, and I have a lot of respect for the regulatory body and also the loyalty work which has to go in. But I'm also a bit surprised that, for example, a market participant in the US is either a swap dealer, a major market, a swap participant, or none of the above. And in Europe, it will be a financial institution. It will be a non-financial institution plus, which means trading a lot in derivatives, or it will be not affected at all. And the list goes down and down. And this is basically where we still stand. I don't have the insights these days to what's going on the regulatory. It's good to hear that there are a lot of talks and a lot of thought about extraterritoriality, but I don't want to be too critical. It's really important that the principles are put in place in such a way that a global institution can trade in both markets in Europe and here, being the most important market, I guess, anyway, in the financial industry, and basically have the same rules. For the financial institutions, I think there are only nine foreign headquartered institutions which now signed up as a swap dealer. Maybe you can confirm that. I don't think there are a lot. That, in my opinion, is way too few, because the participation from foreign institutions in the U.S. market has been significantly higher. So you're probably losing some efficiency there, or you're steering towards concentration. If that happens to be true the other way, the same way that in Europe, you see people retrenching from markets, in my opinion, and this is the institution I'm now also representing, would not be a good development. And it would probably not be good in terms of efficiency. I leave it at this for the time.
George, what's your perception on this situation?
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Gary. Now, I just would like to provide some context. It's, of course, when you look at this issue of cooperation, harmonization, you have to go back to standard setters and Basel, the Basel Committee. Now we have the FSB. It's not the first time that we see this sort of problem. If you go back to Basel II, which was covering banks, we know that Basel II, as mentioned by Dieter, was implemented in Europe, was not implemented in the US, probably given the activities, even cross-border activities of the banks, it was not so much of a problem because you have a lot of integration and interconnectedness within the banking industry. But it's in nature, it's different from the OTC derivatives, because there you have really, as was mentioned by Eric, you have a global market. So from the beginning, there was this commitment at the G20 level. In terms of timeline, it is true that almost by construction, it was possible for the U.S. agencies to move faster than the Commission and the ESMA, because, of course, the Commission and the ESMA are operating in the context of 28 sovereigns. So, of course, it's much more complicated to get people to agree in such a intergovernmental or multinational framework. But still, there was a very strong commitment by the Commission, and you know the Commission in Europe is appointed for 5 years. So there was from the beginning, because the Commission will be renewed this year, so a new Commission was set up in 2009 at the time of Pittsburgh. And there was Barnier, the Commissioner responsible for the single market in Europe, was very clear in saying that they would have a roadmap to roll out as much as possible within the 5 years of the Commission. And they tried to do that. Admittedly, they were not fully successful, not as successful as the CFTC and the SEC, but still, by at least European standards, you may argue that they were quite effective given the context, multinational, and the complexity of the matter. So I think it's the reason why there was some, I'm not from the Commission, so I'm from the European Central Bank and other European Union institution. We are not directly involved in this. We were not in this process because we are not a regulator. We will become a supervisor at the end of this year because we will assume additional responsibilities on top of monetary policy. We'll become supervisor as part of the Banking Union project. But we are involved somehow when it comes to supervision because, as you know, central banks have been involved for many years in the oversight of payment and settlement systems. And now the central banks as overseers are responsible for more than payment systems, because in fact there are new standards that have been introduced by the CPSS, the Committee on the Payment and Settlement System, and IOSCO in Basel, for so-called financial market infrastructures. And financial market infrastructures include not only payment and settlement systems, but also CCPs and central depositories, securities depositories. And through this new approach to oversight of financial market infrastructures, the ECB will be involved is already involved in Europe, in the European Union, in the oversight of CCPs because of the of the impact on payment and settlement system, and also because of the impact on central securities depositories. So we, and I think it's a point I would like to make, is that it was difficult to coordinate or cooperate ex ante on the definition of the rules for OCT derivatives. I think we have seen since 2012 a lot of interaction between in particular the CFTC and the Commission. There is also a so-called financial market regulatory dialogue, which it was mentioned also before, which had a meeting yesterday and today. So it was also important to converge, although late in the process, but to converge and to eliminate quite a few differences or discrepancies that existed. Admittedly, there are still some problems, but at least progress has been made. And in addition, I think one, if you consider that what you your objective is to have some sort of a comparable outcomes in terms of implementing these commitments, I think one needs to look not only at regulation and rulemaking, but also at supervision, because supervision, that is the implementation of the rules, is an integral part of the process. And through supervision, you might also achieve more convergence or harmonization. In particular, when it comes to the recognition of institutions, either financial institutions or swap dealers, by the relevant authorities, but also in the context of so-called, for CCP specifically, that is clearing houses, in the context of so-called cooperative arrangement. That is, these cooperative arrangements are more or less the equivalent of the colleges of supervisors for banks, and they are being set up in Europe. At some point, there will be also a need for US authorities and European authorities to decide how to organize cooperative arrangements for CCPs. To be specific, if the rule is that the central bank of issue, if a CCP is dealing with a euro, the central bank of issue, in this case the ECB, normally should be involved in this cooperative arrangement and this college. So what I'm trying to say here is that it's certainly good to have as much as possible harmonization when it comes to rules, but also if you look at the supervision, that is the way these rules will be implemented by supervisors, there is also another possibility to make sure that you avoid these gaps, overlaps, or conflicts. Thank you.
Now, right after the, I would say about a year after the CFTC proposed its interpretive guidance, on the eve, literally, of finalizing its interpretive guidance, Mr. Barnier from the European Commission and Chairman Gensler got together to try to work out an accord to promote harmony and kumbaya going forward. Dan, I wonder if you can speak on that a little bit, and then talk about, perhaps to the extent you can, how was the final interpretive guidance influenced by that agreement?
Well, the agreement, which was called the Path Forward, was signed, really was agreed to on the eve of the Commission's issuance of the final guidance, and the timing really was driven. The Commission had to, number of provisions were coming to effect in July of last year, and so the Commission needed to get out the guidance, and if it was going to provide any what they call exemptive relief from the application of some of these provisions to give people time to comply, really the Commission had to make a decision by mid-July. The path forward between Chairman Gensler and Mr. Barnier was, I believe, on July 11th, or sort of, right on the eve of that. And it was a very, I thought, optimistic document, forward-looking document, where there was a number of commonalities and areas of mutual understanding and agreement were identified. Substitute of compliance and mutual recognition was a key priority in that document, as was the elements that were Eric mentioned earlier that we were talking about, avoiding gaps, avoiding and avoiding conflicts, and avoiding overlap. Those were the goals. There were a number of areas where the Commission actually stated that it had looked at the European regulations and was confident that either they were comparable or that they were moving towards comparability. So it was very optimistic in that respect. It recognized also that jurisdiction would be territorial based, that each the respective entities had legitimate jurisdiction territorially, and if it was sought to apply that jurisdiction in a way that would impact the territorial of, jurisdiction of other countries, that they would try to avoid conflicts and try to respect other jurisdictions as well. So that was issued on the eve of the final guidance. The final guidance was issued shortly thereafter. Substitute of compliance, again, was a major component of the Commission's final guidance. The Commission laid out a process for substitute of compliance, whereby foreign jurisdictions or entities in foreign jurisdictions could apply to the CFTC for a determination that the jurisdiction and certain requirements within the jurisdiction were comparable. It set out an overarching standard for substitute compliance. One of the issues that had been talked about for some time and debated is, when you talk about substitute compliance, what are you talking about? Are you talking about, do you go regulation by regulation? Do you take out, for CFTC, it's 17 CFR, take out that 500 page, and now it's this thick after Dodd-Frank book of regulations and lay down the EU regulations and say, okay, let's go line by line? Or do you say, what are the overall broad objectives? What are you trying to get here? We're trying to reduce risk, trying to bring transparency to the market. What's the objective of the regulation, and how far do these detailed requirements go in towards meeting those objectives? And do you get pretty much there? And do the, both of these systems, you may say you have to submit your forms in green, you may have to submit your forms in blue font or whatever, but basically are you reducing risk? Or is the type of information that they're submitting so totally not helpful to transparency that it you don't have it? And try to avoid getting too much in the weeds. The path forward set forth a common standard that they would look at the objectives of the regulation in terms of what they were looking for in substituted compliance. And that is something that the Commission also did include in its final guidance.
Eric? So I just wanted to jump on that point. So substituted compliance, or mutual recognition, or equivalence, pick your term, sort of becomes the special sauce to resolve a lot of these apparent differences. But I think we have to think very carefully as to what exactly substantive compliance or equivalence really means. You know, so Dan's talking about, you know, you're not going to do a rule-by-rule analysis. That would not really make sense. We've all talked about this notion of outcomes-based, but that's actually a very important point, because we have very different legal regimes. We have different regulatory histories. We have different ways we regulate. And what you're looking for is, well, what is the regulatory outcome that's achieved by the various regulations to decide comparability? But in addition, you have to talk about, can you do substantive compliance when you have different implementation timelines? Is it even possible to do a comparability determination if the other jurisdiction has not yet finished the rules? So therefore, you know, matching of timing is very important. There is been the argument made that that one jurisdiction should wait for the other jurisdiction to finish the rules. Is that really practical? What if the jurisdiction needs another 2 years? In that 2-year period, are you going to leave the market unregulated? At the same time, you know, it kind of rewards those who come out with the rules first. Third is, you know, if you do a comparison, let's say we say outcomes are theoretically the same. How do we know that in reality this is how the outcomes actually are achieved? You got to look at how vigorously rules are enforced, or how well entities are being supervised. That's very challenging. There's been a lot of academic literature on enforcement intensity. Do you look at how many enforcement lawyers they have in their agency? Do you look at how many fines they've levied in the past 2 years to get a sense of how effective the enforcement regime is? That's something that needs to be considered. And finally, legal frameworks. You know, it's been mentioned cooperative arrangements, what in US parlance, MOUs. You need to start negotiating frameworks of supervisory cooperation and enforcement cooperation, MOUs. A lot of that has not been done yet and will take time to do. So substantive compliance, on one hand, is a very simple and powerful idea, but to actually put it into reality is going to take a tremendous amount of thinking.
But isn't the alternative to have basically a very pillared world where folks are limited to doing business in their jurisdiction, and the implications on the global economy could actually be relatively devastating?
I guess that is another scenario, but I mean, I think it's by virtue of the fact that substantive compliance has been proposed by both the U.S. agencies, equivalence is something that the Europeans have pushed forward very powerfully, and other jurisdictions will have equivalence regimes. There's clearly a desire to avoid that from happening.
Sure, but the problem is, I mean, the reality is you're never going to get a complete. You might get close to equivalence. The timing will always be somewhat out. My guess is that by the time that MiFID II is enacted, the U.S. laws on the subjects of MiFID II may have been substantially amended because whatever the political pressures are in the United States at that point. In fact, one of the issues is, isn't there a trade-off here between economic efficiency and a certain legal certainty or harmony?
There may be. I don't think the gap problem can be minimized. It's not just a question of evasion, that people will go to the lesser jurisdiction in the interim. It's also a question of a level playing field competitively, because it's very difficult to ask U.S. companies to have to comply with one legal regime when foreign entities doing the very same things don't have to comply with another legal regime, and to maintain even the domestic application in many instances. And the markets change. If you're talking 2 years, 2 years in one of these markets, all the customers can go to totally different entities, and it's not when 2 years later you can't get it back.
Let me hold you on that point for 1 second. Since the enactment of Dodd-Frank in particular, a new word has evolved and become much more prevalent. It's called futurization. We saw last October 2013 where a clearinghouse magically, overnight, took their entire swaps book on a Friday, and by Monday, they were futures trades. It was just utter magic. That's by process of novation and all sorts of other application. And we've seen now more and more folks in the industry walking back, certainly from the statements they made back in 1990 when the commodity futures modernization was enacted, which was that swaps are individualized, particularized, non-standardized product, to, of course they're standardized, of course they're, you know, there's lots of commonality. Of course there's bespoke swaps, but 95% of them are very, very standardized. Had you been aware of this debate, had the policymakers been thinking this way, had they not bought into the differential nature of swaps back in 2010, certainly on the Hill, do you think the outcome would have been different? Would we be going down a different line in how we look at the regulation, not just internationally, but even domestically?
It's possible. I remember back in back when Dodd-Frank was first introduced, or even before it was introduced, when Chairman Gensler was up for his confirmation hearings, he was asked, why can't we just, you have to trade futures? And that position was considered way out of the midstream.
Oh, absolutely.
That there was swaps and there was futures, and you couldn't treat really swaps like futures, and that was one thing, and this was something else. There was obviously a recognition of the economic equivalence of these instruments, and that's one reason why you had a regulated market and unregulated market, and from a policy perspective, that was difficult to maintain. But nonetheless, they were distinct, and their markets were distinct, and people didn't foresee what you were talking about, the futurization, that it could flip like that. And the regulators, at least our agency, it wasn't foreseen.
Isn't it, maybe it's through the regulatory arbitrage, basically, that what it comes down to, and it's across jurisdictions even more prevalent than it is within one jurisdiction, as the case here.
Yeah.
The question would be, you know, how to avoid it or how to be able to react quicker upon it. And I think if it's not futures, it will be something else rather soon. And the question is, what instruments do we have available which are flexible enough to basically see the developments and do something about it?
Now, just a couple of fact things that I think may be brought out. Dan, maybe you can comment a little bit that not the entire industry wasn't exactly thrilled with the international guidance, and there was a lawsuit filed by ISDA and some other participants last December 4th against the CFTC. Maybe you just give us a few thoughts about the arguments in the lawsuit, and what do you think the merits are of that lawsuit?
The lawsuit by SIFMA, ISDA, and the Institute for International Banking was filed last December, scheduled to be briefed in the district court, U.S. District Court in the District of Columbia. The CFTC's appeals from CFTC orders and regulations are in the district court in D.C. The briefing schedules for the spring, possibly we would have an oral argument late spring and a decision maybe late spring, early summer. The complaint essentially alleges that the two things, and they're complementary arguments, that the guidance that we've been talking about, the interpretive guidance, is really a rulemaking. We said, why did you do a guidance rather than a rule? Well, the lawsuit takes the position that this guidance is essentially so detailed and prescriptive and points to a number of statements in the Federal Register release, as well as speeches and press statements and reporters and whatever, where the statement has been made about must comply, entities must comply, that these rules, and the lawsuit alleges that the intent really is not just to issue guidance, but binding regulations. It's an important legal distinction. When the CFTC said it's guidance, in Administrative Procedure Act, APA, guidance is not legally binding. It's just guidance. And if you can't take somebody to court and charge them with violating guidance. Guidance gives the market participants guidance on how the agency will approach a problem, but always in the facts and circumstances of particular instances, that guidance might not necessarily dictate the outcome. But the lawsuit basically says the guidance really isn't guidance, it's essentially a rule. And as a rule, you didn't go through all the Administrative Procedure Act procedures in promulgating it. There's not all the substantive requirements for the APA process were not met. The things you had to consider, you didn't consider. You didn't respond to all comments properly. And not an APA problem, but a Commodity Exchange Act problem, you did not consider costs and benefits. The CEA, the Commodity Exchange Act, requires the Commission, when it issues a regulation or an order, to consider the costs and benefits of its action. So the lawsuit says, this is essentially a regulation, and therefore you did not follow the statutory mandate to consider costs and benefits. The Commission will argue, they've indicated they will argue this, but the Commission will argue, no, indeed, it is guidance. It is not binding. We've always said it's not binding. They will point to at least as many, if not more, statements that say it's not binding, and that will be the fundamental issue for the court to decide, with what box does this fall in. The corollary argument is, that the industry is lawsuit is making is that each of the rules I was talking earlier about, when the CFTC went through the rulemaking process, it explicitly determined it would not address cross-border in each rule. So when people commented on put in comments during the rulemaking process saying, what about the cross-border application of this? In many instances, the CFTC said, we're not doing cross-border here, we're gonna issue guidance on it later. And so the industry lawsuit alleges that in each of these individual rulemakings, the Commission did not consider comments properly, did not respond to their comments. They said, we'll get to it some other time, and that they didn't consider the cross-border application. They didn't do a proper cost-benefit. So each of the rules then would be deficient. So ultimately, the industry is asking that each of these 14 rules, basically the entity and transaction level requirements.
Who's going to win?
Well, it's interesting because what would the remedy be? I mean, if the court throws out the guidance and says the guidance
is there's out of confusion.
Yeah, I mean, in many respects, in my view, it's somewhat of a nuclear option. then there is no guidance, and then you're back to everybody's statutorily interpreting the statute on their own. It wouldn't preclude the CFTC for enforcing it if all you did was throw out the guidance. If you think about, well, could the one of the things that the lawsuit asks is for the CFTC to be enjoined from enforcing this cross-border, enjoin the application of the statute. But one would think about how the court would try to contemplate how a court would actually do that. The court would have to issue its own guidance as to what cross-border application of the statute is and saying it doesn't apply in these circumstances. That's a major undertaking for the court to do. So I'm not sure that that is such a realistic outcome. And if you invalidate the guidance and say you have to go through a rulemaking, then where are you? Then what do people rely on in terms of cross-border application? And one of the fundamental concerns always in this area is if the CFTC, if the agency is not setting forth rules that sort of establish the rules of the road or guidance on the rules of the road, and it's left for the market participants to hash it out all themselves, is there in the Commodity Exchange Act, there's a private right of action, and people can sue each other for violating the act. So one person says, I think it should be interpreted this way, and you've interpreted it that way, and I want out of my deal because you interpreted it the wrong way, then you really do have chaos. You have a lot of lawsuits, and you have people trying to unwind deals, and it's not a good situation if that were to happen.
Eric, very, very quickly, substantively, is there a big outtrade between the approach of the SEC and its proposed rules versus what the CFTC has finally done? And also, just procedurally, when are we likely to see the final rules from the SEC, and what were generally the comments and reactions to the SEC rules?
So let me answer the first question first, because actually, when the SEC put out its cross-border release, it also put out a much smaller release asking, among other things, a very basic question: do you, the public, prefer us to draft rules that are consistent with the CFTC rules, or would you prefer that we draft rules as we think are best, right? Which could be better or worse than the CFTC rules. Generally, the comments were much more in favor toward consistency, regardless of whether or not the CFTC, what the SEC wanted to do would be considered better or worse than the CFTC rules. So that's something to take in consideration. And obviously, we're in the middle of rulemaking, so it's something we'll just have to ponder. In terms of how soon are we going to start seeing details, I think our chair has said, 2014, given the list of rules, probably won't be done by 2014, but 2014 to 2015, you're going to start seeing the various Title VII rules being finalized, starting off with reporting and then clearing. And then the market intermediaries, including securities-based swap dealers, and finally trading would probably be the last group, and cap and margin. Hopefully, they're going to start coming out. The calendar, unfortunately, is unpredictable. So I can't say more than that. Regarding differences, I think there are some differences, but I think there's also, they're generally consistent with each other. So that's all I can really say on that topic.
And Judge, one thing we haven't covered, which I think might be interesting for the audience, is as I said, Europe is a complicated place, and there's lots of directives and lots of rules out there. And obviously, it's always been my experience that the capital rules effectuate a lot of regulation indirectly, and certainly that's going to be the case with Basel III. And I'm just curious about your thoughts on whether what you're seeing is proposed capital rules, whether what you're seeing is proposed liquidity standards, in fact, are supportive, whether they need to still be amended, with promoting central clearing of OTC derivatives.
I would tend to think so. Mainly, there are two arguments there. One is, if you look at the liquidity coverage ratio and the net stability, net stable funding ratio, you see that there is this notion of high quality liquidity assets, and which means that the banks will try to use collateral as efficiently as possible. CCPs, if you look, there are many positive features regarding CCPs, like transparency, addressing the issue of asymmetry of information, risk management. But I think one of the most important advantage or merit of CCPs, and it was mentioned recently by Benoît Curé, who is the member of the board of the ECB and is chair of the CPSS, is the impact of CCPs on through netting on collateral management. That is the fact that CCPs allow participants to economize on collateral. So from this perspective, financial intermediaries would have an interest in participate in CCPs, because this would be more efficient from the perspective of use of collateral. Another aspect is, of course, the fact that at least in Europe, I don't know about the US, but in the EU, in the Basel III implementation, that is CRD4, which is a directive implementing Basel III. There's a directive and a regulation. Directive, as you know, implies that there's a need for the member countries to transpose that into their own legislation, while the regulation is applicable directly. But in this new regulation and directive implementing Basel III, there is also, in terms of risk-weighted asset, when banks, financial intermediaries are dealing with CCPs that are recognized, then the risk weight is lower than if it's not the case. So also from the perspective of use of capital by banks, there is incentive to go through CCPs. And another point, but it's also these new rules in terms of liquidity in particular would have implications also for central banks, not only for CCPs, because of the collateral in particular, for depending on the collateral framework of the central banks, the fact that the banks would have to keep high quality liquid asset for the market operation, there might be also an incentive to get more liquidity directly from the central banks. But this is a different issue.
Thank you. Dietmar, before we take any questions, do you have any final thoughts on this discussion?
Yes, we have spoken a lot about derivatives, maybe one or two other topics. Take your question you had in the morning, you know, when you said, was it fair or that losses have been socialized and profits have been privatized, so to speak. And there's indeed something done about that as well. Moral hazard has been in all the new regulation has been a major, major topic to avoid moral hazard going forward. And here too, the US has moved more rapidly and first with regard to bringing resolution plans into play and bringing so-called SIFIs into play, systemically important financial institutions. And these are all being implemented as we speak. For SIFIs, they are already. And the idea would be that whenever a financial institution or a bank is no longer viable, it will be dismantled. Europe is a very different point there. We have the banking union, which is similar to that concept, but that's stuttering a little bit. And George has said it before, you know, whenever you do something in Europe, particularly with directives, you need the EU Commission. You need the Parliament and you need the Council, and the Council actually is 28 countries who have to basically agree on it and take it into their law. And the Banking Union has been a very, very important case because the economic weight of the different countries are so different, and the agreement to can European funds be used or when can they be used in the ESM is very important, and when do we have national funds being used to bail out or bail in shareholders or stakeholders in these institutions. I think that's an important point too, and I think at the end of the day it will come out similar to what you have as resolution planning in the United States. For MiFID II, maybe a final thought. It is brand new. It was agreed upon. I'm pretty sure that this will be put in law and I think it will be also followed the U.S. example. There might be some differences to what we said, but I think the principles are fully intact in that respect. I think this is very positive. And yes, we don't want to have regulatory competition, but we also want to have efficiencies across across the transatlantic. That's our topic. I think that's very important. And from my feeling, I think it's a very very good development in that area as well.
And just finally, before we take maybe one or two questions, we will get a very quick indication of where the spirit of cooperation is between the United States and Europe, as I mentioned in the introduction, because following up on George's point, there is a date in February, and I'm not exactly sure, I think it's mid-February, Dan or Eric may know the precise date, where it's critical that U.S. CCPs are recognized as qualified CCPs by their European regulators. And right now there's some outtrades, because in fact the European regulators don't see the U.S. CCPs as meeting certain high standards in the area of margin collected. Europe typically is on a two-day coverage scenario, whereas the Americans are on one. And in the area of customer funds protection, there's an opportunity for individual customer funds segregation under the European scenario. Doesn't exist today in the U.S. exactly. And so both the U.S. and European regulators are meeting in Washington right now to see whether they can iron out the differences. There's some basis to figure that out, but that's an important discussion happening. We'll give some indication whether the tone is changing now that there's a new chairman at the CFTC. I know we're just ran out of time, but maybe there's a question or two that anybody would like to ask? Well, there's no questions. Thank the panelists, and we'll have our break.